Hello all, welcome back to this session on cryptography, network security and cyber law, which is brought to you by the VTU eShikshana program. Today, what we are going to do is learn a new concept called the intrusion detection system. So before I start, I would like to start sharing my screen so that you get to see the slides. Okay, I hope you all can see the slides now. Okay, so this is the cryptography, network security and cyber law 17CS61. I'm Dr. Padma Shriti. I am from the Department of ISC, RV College of Engineering. I am responsible for teaching you the module 4 of cryptography, network security and cyber law. As a part of this course, I am here to teach you the intrusion prevention detection today. In this chapter, we are going to study an introduction to intrusion prevention and detection, prevention and detection. What is the difference between the two? The types of intrusion detection systems, the DDoS attacks, how do you prevent them and how do you detect them? So today we are just going to cover this part of it. The reference book that I am using is the Cryptography, Network Security and Cyber Law, Bernard Menes. This is the VTU prescribed textbook. As a part of this, I will be covering the following chapters. I have already covered a few chapters, which you already know. We'll see what we have done till now. In the previous session, I've taught you firewalls. So in the current session, you will be reading IDS, which is all a part of module 4. So till now, we have covered firewalls, its functionality, what are the policies, what is a ACL, a sample ACL also we have seen, firewall types, what are the issues with firewall, how do you place a firewall, and what are the other configuration issues that we face with the firewall. So today we will learn about the intrusion prevention and detection. We will see a clear difference between the prevention versus the detection. What are the types of IDS and how do you prevent or detect a DDoS attack? This is what we are going to see today. So before we start, I will just check if you can, if you're able to see the slide. Okay, now that I have switched off my camera, I think you will be able to see the slides clearly. Okay, so let us start with today's session, intrusion prevention and detection. So what is intrusion according to you? Everybody would have heard of this term intrusion. Intrusion means an intruder entering into an area where he is not authorized to enter into. Intruder is an unknown person or an unauthorized person who is trying to gain entry into a zone where he is not supposed to enter. That is intrusion. The whole process is called as intrusion. This generally happens. We have a security at the apartment gateway where who checks who belongs to this apartment. He also checks who's entering the apartment, who's leaving the apartment. If you are an unauthorized resident of that apartment, he keeps track of you. He's going to ask you questions before you get into the apartment. So this is about intrusion. With our computer systems, the same concept holds good. So what is intrusion? Intrusion is nothing but unauthorized login. You are not supposed to log into a system you are not authorized to log into. So that when you do so, that will result in unauthorized login. Intrusion just does not happen when somebody enters into a place where he is not supposed to. It also happens through worm infection. What is this worm infection that we are talking about? So these worm infections, they use a system as a launch pad and they spread and infect all the other machines that your system is talking to. That is worm infection. So injection of spyware through a virus in your computer could also be another reason for intrusion. So when you have a spyware, it is passively monitoring all the activities that you are performing on your computer and it is going to relay this information to the attacker, whoever has initiated this attack. So another way of intrusion is flooding the host. what is it going to flood with data packets? It could be request packets, could be data packets. So flooding the host with spurious connection request. So why do they do that? What is the main aim? The aim is to exhaust the target's resources, computing resources. I mean to say processing power, memory, communication bandwidth. It could be anything, right? So when the resource is out of resource, or when the destination or the attack, the possible system which is prone to attack is out of resources, he's going to stop his activities. So that is why this is a flooding the host is also a part of the intrusion. Okay, now what do we talk about prevention and detection. So there are two ways of handling this kind of intrusion. Intrusion prevention and intrusion detection are the two ways of handling this. Now we will clearly see what is prevention and what is detection. First thing is prevention. How do you prevent an intrusion from happening to your computer system? The first and foremost thing all of us should remember is our computer should be guarded by an antivirus software or a firewall or any kind of a defense mechanism. How do you prevent yourself from getting a disease? You take vaccination, right? You're preventing something. You are building a line of defense over your body, your immunity system, so that you don't get certain diseases. Same way, our computer systems, you should be able to eliminate the software vulnerabilities. This we have already discussed. How do we eliminate software vulnerabilities in one of the previous chapters? Then programmers, when they are programming softwares, they should adopt practices which will help or eliminate the software vulnerabilities. Okay, what do I mean by saying this? Good programming practices, coding techniques will always help keep the software safe and free from vulnerabilities. For example, string manipulation functions in C++ can be used, and use of parameterized SQL queries. They are recommended usually for any program to protect against any kind of a attack on the programming side, be it a SQL injection attack or a buffer overflow attack, etc. Right? When you are sending an input through HTML pages also, the user input from which is coming from the HTML forms should be sanitized. Sanitized in a sense, it should be checked for any kind of a script, hidden script that is running in the HTML form. So that's a kind of prevention. So another thing is that the computer system, if I buy a laptop from a store, the laptop comes with operating system and a compiler. Necessarily, right? If you are doing some execution. So these computing system, the operating system, the hardware, the compiler should provide a second line of defense by default. Then you should configure a firewall on your network based on what you are doing, based on your role. If you are at home, if you're using your computer only for your personal purposes, home purposes, then your laptop Windows firewall, your operating system firewall is sufficient, your antivirus software would be sufficient. But if you are working for an organization, then the organization should have firewalls. You should configure the firewall in the right manner. We have already covered the firewall chapter, so I think you will be knowing how the configuration of firewall. Next is deterrence. Deterrence is avoiding hacking. Even for fun, it is not recommended that any of you students should learn hacking. Okay, and you should also be responsible citizens and should not provoke or motivate anyone else to hack. Now, this could be a thrill. This could be a thrill, but it would land you in trouble. It could be a cyber attack on somebody and you might be caught by the cyber police. You should never try to hack anybody else's system, even for fun. Let's talk a little bit about detection. Detection in intrusion detection system will perform three tasks mainly. First one is it is going to monitor, analyze, and alert. right? These are the three tasks. The first one is monitoring. Okay, what is it going to monitor? It is going to monitor the events that are happening in a computing system. We call it the events of interest. Okay, on the target system, we observe the events of interest. The IDS essentially observes events of interest. An event of interest, it could be a system call, right? It could be a system call, or it could be an attempt to establish a connection with your computer. If you know the person who is trying to establish a computer connection with your computer, well and good, or else you will have to check who it is. Then analyze. IDS generates a large amount of data, which it is going to analyze later, and it is going to come to conclusions based on this data that is being collected, right? So it is going to be converted to valuable information, which is going to be used by the system administrators, right? So that is analysis. Generating alerts. We talked about interesting events, events of interest. So when interesting events are happening, alert has to be raised for somebody to take action. When you think that your computer is compromised, an alert has to be generated to the system administrator or to yourself. Generally, if you log in to your Gmail account from a device which you don't generally use, you get an alert onto your email ID saying that there is a unknown device login, right? That's an alert. That's exactly the alert. It's an unknown activity. Google suspects that something has happened wrong somewhere, even if it is you. If it is you, nothing to worry, but you are alerted, whether good or bad, that something wrong or has happened, or something unusual has happened and it is detected. This the tasks of IDS, which we just talked about. You can take a look at this flowchart. You will understand it better. The IDS is going to monitor various network parameters. All of us know that network has so many different variables, right? It could be number of access to a specific file. It could be TCP header flags. It could be operating system calls. It could be TCP connection establishment requests. Anything. It is going to monitor all these network variables. Based on the monitoring, the IDS will analyze the recent value or the behavior of each of the variables. If at all these behavior is going to match an attack pattern, it is going to raise an alarm, right? If it is not matching an attack pattern, but is this an anomalous behavior, then it is going to raise an alarm. So this is the overview of the functioning of the task of the IDS. Okay, so now unauthorized user logins we were talking about, right? So we will just see a small case study on this, that is unauthorized user login, how an IDS can take care of it. Now, how do you prevent an unauthorized login into your email ID? Just think about it. Your password is the first gateway to enter into your email account. Your password should be strong enough. Right? The strength of the password should be strong enough. That means it should have characters, numbers, special characters, uppercases, etc. So that any different combination of a set of letters nobody will be able to guess what your password is. Your password strength, if it is low, anybody will be able to hack it. It should not be based on something generally that the public knows, correct? Your date of birth, everybody will know these days, correct? Then it shouldn't be your son's name or your daughter's name or your spouse name, right? Something that the world knows, it shouldn't be that, correct? So the strength of the password should be strong. It is very important that we all change our passwords regularly to avoid any kind of a activity that is going to happen. I'm just taking the example of an email account because it's easy for you to understand. This happens for getting into somebody else's system also. Okay, then store password regularly, it says. So it is, I think it is not regularly, it should be securely. Okay, so the password should be stored securely. Password should be stored securely. You don't store the list of all your passwords in a text document on your desktop, right? That is a very wrong way of storing password. You can't remember 100 passwords, don't worry, store it securely. But as far as I suggest, you don't store it. As long as you can, you please give passwords that you can remember. Don't store it anywhere, right? Okay, then the system that you're using should be designed to disable functionalities on unsuccessful login attempts, right? After 3 attempts to your bank login, it'll get locked. You have to do a big circus calling the customer representative, right? And then you will have to give your details, tell them that yes, you did it, you forgot the password, you did the 3 attempts. That is the system, banking system design, which is going to disable all the functionalities based on the number of login attempts. To err is human, so based on first failure of login attempt, your account won't be locked. And even if it does, that system is not a good system because all of us tend to forget, right? It is the basic nature of human being to forget things. But it is not suggested to try your password again and again and lock your own system. And if at all that happens, that is detected as an intrusion. Okay, it is going to, the intrusion detection system is going to monitor suspicious login and unsuccessful logins. Okay, we'll go more on to the IDS types. The IDS, the basic functionality of an IDS, based on this, we are going to divide IDS into different types. One is the anomaly based IDS, the other one is the signature based IDS. We also have host based IDS and network based IDS. We'll see what each of these are. Okay, now I was talking about parameters or variables, right? What does this IDS generally think the parameters are? These 10 points that you see here are the events of interest or the variables or the parameters that the IDS considers in order to determine if a certain system is being intruded. Okay, the first thing could be number of accesses to a specific file. As I told you, TCP header flags, operating system calls, payload of the incoming packet. Is there an unknown connection request at the transport layer? Percentage of half open TCP connections, very interesting, right? So these are all events of interest. Somebody has created a TCP connection and left it halfway. He could have forgotten it and gone. But how many such halfway open TCP connections exist on your system? It could be a sign of intrusion. So that is also a variable of interest. We'll now see what each of these anomaly signature based IDS are. Anomaly based IDS, it is going to determine the system, whether the behavior of the system is a statistically significant departure from the normal. It is not the usual kind of a behavior that the system is displaying today. So it is departing from its original behavior. The first six from this slide, the first six variables or the first six parameters from this, they determine the anomaly based IDS. Signature based misuse detection, we call, right? Or signature based IDS system, it is going to work by identify patterns of events or patterns of behavior. Patterns of behavior for a particular attack. So what it is going to do is it should have previous knowledge of attacks. It is going to maintain a signature of all the attacks that have happened previously, and it is going to compare this kind of a pattern with the already existing data in the database of known signatures. So based on that, it is going to generate an alarm. We'll see what is a host-based and network-based IDS. Network-based IDS, it is going to capture information about the packets that are flowing through the network. It could be coming into a network or going out of a network. This network-based IDS is going to store information. This generally, network-based IDS is found in organizations. As a part of the firewall, IDS can be incorporated and it is going to perform this function. Host-based IDS, generally this is what we use. Okay, on our operating system, there is a software which is going to detect all our activities or keep log of all our activities. It is going to make use of the system logs, application logs, operating system audit trails, everything to determine if there is a spurious activity. Generally, host-based IDS will come along with our operating system, one layer on the operating system. All the files that are modified in your host system are kept track of, and that's called as the file integrity checker, right? So host-based IDS can be a file integrity. All host-based IDS do not have a file integrity checker. Definitely, it will have system logs and application logs, but file integrity checker is an additional package or an additional API along with the host-based IDS. Two features of IDS are speed and accuracy. Okay, these are the two important features of any IDS. Speed is important. Why? Because in the fast-spreading internet worms, early worm detection and early response mechanisms, such as automated system shutdown, it will help reduce the number of infected machines across the network. Okay, so accuracy is also very important because IDS should be able to detect every instance of intrusion. Okay, any undetected intrusion is called as a false negative. Any undetected intrusion, what you see here, is called as a false negative. Intrusion which has not occurred but IDS alerts, that is called as false positive. So for IDS, you have to know what is speed, and in accuracy, you should know what is false negative and false positive. There are two other aspects, which are sensitivity and collectivity. I don't know, it is not here, but I'll just tell you what is sensitivity and what is selectivity. These are the aspects of IDS: accuracy, sensitivity, and selectivity. High sensitivity implies low false negative rate. Okay, low false negative rate. So almost all intrusion is detected here in sensitive IDS. It is very sensitive. In selectivity, low false positive rate. Okay, low false positive rate. Selectivity is, it is not going to simply tell and give a wrong alert. Okay, so it is not going to simply give a wrong alert. So accuracy is determined on sensitivity and selectivity. Okay. Next, distributed denial of service. We all know what it is. We know what the DDoS attack is. So prevention and detection of DDoS attack. Now, DDoS prevention can happen in two places, one at the host and the other at the network. At the host, we all know that in transport layer, in order to establish a TCP connection, sync packet has to be sent. To handle the sync attack, right, drop the request for TCP connection. Now, what is the sync attack? Sync attack is generating more number of SYN packets in order to establish connection with the target system. I want to connect to a target system. I will send one packet now. In 1 minute, I'll send 1,000 SYN packets. So you're going to flood the system. So what we have to do is, at the system level, not we, the IDS system, the IDS will drop the request for TCP connection. The IDS will also maintain a sync cache, which is a hash table that is going to maintain information about half open TCP connections. We talked just now about this half open TCP connection. Any connection, three-way handshake, we all remember in transport layer? Yes. So any connection that has not gone through the entire three-way connection will be a half open TCP connection. Why is this half open? Is somebody observing me? Right? So there is a sync cache which is going to keep track of all such connections in form of a hash table. A sync cookie is also maintained, which stores the state information. Right? Sorry, it is not going to store any state information at all. Okay. The responding machine will place the cookie within the sequence number of the second handshake message. So that's how they maintain the systems maintain a sync cookie. Okay. See, why is it not storing any state information? It is not going to store, please remember, it is not going to store state information for the half open TCP connections only. In that way, instead of this, the responding machine will place a cookie within the sequence number field of the second handshake message. Then the cookie is computed as a hash function of the source address, destination address, source port, destination port, and a secret key. Hope you all understood. So the initiator of the connection dispatches the cookie. It just received in its acknowledgement message, and that will be the third message of the three-way handshake. Upon receiving this acknowledgement, the responder will again recalculate the cookie and verifies that it is matching with the already received cookie, acknowledgement cookie, right? So this way, it is going to prevent any kind of a illegal TCP connection that is being trying to establish connection with my system. Okay, then preventive measures inside the network. Inside the network, an egress filtering should happen. Okay, implement measures close to the source of attack. Okay, so most DDoS attack packets use the source, right? Use the spoofed source IP addresses which are spoofed. So address spoofing is employed. Why is it used? To confuse people and make it hard to trace the source of attack. So the perpetrator hopes to continue the attack for as long as desired and even resume it at a later point of time. Okay, so what is an egress router? Let's first see. Egress router is the last router that is encountered by any packet before leaving that network. That's an egress router, last router. It is close to the source. So it detects and filters all the spoofed packets. The IDS system can also have distributed route filtering, which is also called as a DRF. So this is going to keep track of the route a packet is going to take to reach the destination. Okay, this filtering is maintained for each of the interfaces. So the set of all source addresses from which the packet arrive via the routers to some destination is kept track of, right? So the router is going to use BGP routing information to get the latest mapping between each of its interfaces and the subset of source addresses that use this information. I hope you all got it, right? Next. To detect the onset of denial of service attack and take remedial action is also just another function of the IDS. In sync flood, proportion of sync to fin packet, if it is not appropriate, then it is a matter of concern. We need to think about it. Why is that? the number of SYN packets that I'm not getting is not equal to the number of FIN packets. Any connection that is established has to be released. I hope you all remember that FIN packets are used for connection release in TCP. These SYN and FIN is usually occurs in pairs, and in normal termination, one SYN packet will have a corresponding FIN packet. If it is not proportionate, it's a matter of concern. So we need algorithms to detect the onset of SYN flood attack. There are two algorithms which are very simple. Algorithm one will raise an alert if the most recently computed detection variable exceeds the threshold. Algorithm two will raise an alert if the average of the previous values exceed the threshold. So, average, these are the two algorithms based on which the number of SYN packets which are coming into a network are kept in track in order to determine whether the connections that are being established to a certain system is legal or not. We'll see this pictorially so that we can understand it better. You see here the number of SYN packets, the number of FIN packets, TCP connection establishment and termination, the usual sequence of events that happen. But in the SYN timeline and FIN timeline, they should be synchronous. They should be a ratio, proportionate ratio of the SYN packets with their corresponding FIN packets. Right? If that does not happen, then it is a matter of concern. For DDoS detection, there's yet another kind of a technique which is called as IP traceback. There are two principal approaches for IP traceback. The packet keeps tracks of routers it has visited, and that is called as packet marking. Packet itself, wherever it is going to reach from the source till the destination, is going to keep track of all the routers it has visited on the way. Packet marking. Then another way is that routers will keep track of all the packets that is passing through it. That's called as packet logging. That is called as packet logging. What picture you see there is a probabilistic packet marking technique. So you have a map of the upstream routers. Okay, then what does it look like? Router fingerprint ID in the field of the IP header. This is the IP header. Okay, this is the IP header. So packets will keep track of all the routers that they have visited, right? So it is going to look something like this. The fingerprint is going to look something like this. Now, ingress routers we were talking about, we always assume that each of these ingress routers that we have talked about has a map of all the upstream routers from it. Then only the probabilistic packet marking will make some sense. Okay. Next technique is the packet logging. Router attempts to keep track of every packet that it is going to pass through it. Right? Now, while packet marking made the made use of the idea of router fingerprint, packet logging will make use of packet fingerprint. Router fingerprint, packet fingerprint. Okay, now this will help in tracking a single rogue packet. Even if there is a single rogue packet, then we can try to keep it. But the problem with this kind of a logging is the storage issue. Thousands and millions of packets will pass through a router. If it keeps track of all the packets, it would be a lot of storage. In order to reduce the storage requirement, Bloom's filter can be applied. Okay, Bloom's filter, how does it work? So if you say that n is the maximum number of packets that is to be stored in a router for a given interval, say 7 minutes. So on element insertion, hash is calculated, and this hash is called as the, this hash is the, is it, it is, it is referring to the packet, right? Hash is on element insertion, packet insertion, hash is calculated. K independent hash functions are used. Okay, and these independent hash functions are distinct. They are different from one another in order to calculate the hash. Output of each of these hash function is a quantity, and we say that's a W bit quantity. Okay, it is a W bit quantity. Let me just correct this so that it does not confuse you. The Bloom filter is a bit array, right? It's nothing but a bit array, and it is going to calculate M is equal to 2 to the power W, M is equal to 2 to the power W. And that is the size of the array. That is the size of the array. So packet insertion and packet presence check happen in Bloom filter. In packet insertion, when a packet enters the router, the K hashes are computed. Okay. So when K hashes are computed, to speed up that computation, they are only computed on invariant parts of the IP header and small part of the payload. These K hash outputs, they are indices to the bit array. Okay, now to insert the packet, the bits in those positions are all set to 1. They are all set to 1. In packet presence check, to check if a certain packet P is present in Bloom's filter, K hashes are computed during packet insertion. K hash computations, they yield I1, I2, I3, so many different values. Now you check whether each of these IK elements of the Bloom's filter are set. When once they are set, if anything is a zero, then P has not been encountered by this route. Right? So that packet P has not been encountered by this router. Now, this is how, one second, this is how a Bloom's filter looks like. False positive can happen in a Bloom's filter also. There's a lot of mathematical model that is involved in this Bloom filter. So packet insertion happens, right? Packet insertion happens. Packet presence check for P7 also happens. H1, H2, H3 are calculated. If there is a zero, they all have encountered a one. If it has encountered a zero, then P7 has not gone through a certain router. Right? So H1, H2, H3 hashes are computed by each of these routers. For every packet, 3 hashes. P7, H1, H2, H3, P309, H1, H2, H3, P1054, H1, H2, H3 is calculated and inserted. Then presence check, again hash is calculated, and it is going to determine if it exists. If it does not exist, then that packet is not there. But here what happens in our case, 111, there is no zero element that has been encountered by the hash. So that means that packet is been encountered. That means PN is inserted, correct? Okay, so that's the end of your chapter 21, which talks about intrusion, prevention and detection. So I'll just make it clear to you all a little bit that in my syllabus, if you just take a look at this chapter, let me just verify if it is being recorded. Yeah. Okay, I'm audible, right? Okay, fine. So in this, what I was trying to tell you is, in chapter 21, you only have 21.1 and 21.2 for your VTU syllabus, and that covers the entire thing. That is going to cover whatever is there in red here, whatever you see here is going to be covered by that. Okay, so I hope you've got the concept of intrusion, prevention and detection. This is a very simple concept and not at all difficult to understand. All you have to do is go back and read this chapter. If at all there is any questions that you need to ask, you can always feel free to get back to me. My name is Padmashri and I work in ISC department of RV College of Engineering. I haven't put my email address here. I haven't put it here. So, but still, if you get into the rvce.edu.in website under the Information Science Department, you can see my name, and they have shared the email ID to the public. Okay, thank you all. We'll get back, we'll come back for the next one, web security concepts, right? Till then, all of you keep studying and stay safe. Thank you.